We're good for all of two slides. My apologies. So just a quick introduction. Sorry about that, everyone, for the macroinvertebrate data mining study introduction prior to Cody's presentation. Little background on the study. The study was recommended by the science team to the action team and the stakeholders team as a priority study among a long list of potential Hinkson Creek studies in the 2019 science strategy document. We'll be having more to say about the science strategy document in a couple weeks in the last presentation. The purpose of the study was to analyze stressor metrics from MDNR's existing invertebrate data, of which there are years of data, and determine if there were additional metrics that could help indicate the sources of impairment to Hinkson Creek. So it was basically an addition of many other measuring tools to see if we could uncover anything, any other information from existing data. The study was funded by the CAM stakeholders, the City of Columbia, Boone County, and the University of Missouri. And the action team put together a proposal for the study and bid it out, with the award going to Geosyntec. So with that, I will stop presenting, and hopefully everything will work well, and I'll have a few more slides at the end.
Hey, thank you, Tim. This is Cody Luebbering with Geosyntec. I'm going to share my screen. Michelle, can you confirm that you can see the presentation?
Yes, I can.
Okay, great. I appreciate it. All right. Well, welcome action team, science team members, and stakeholders to the Hinkson Creek Macroinvertebrate Data Mining Project. As Tim said, I work for Geosyntec. My name is Cody Luebbering. I've worked with water quality, water quantity, aquatic ecological data for the past 15 years. I do have with me Dr. Sam McCord. Would you like to introduce yourself, Sam?
Yeah, I'm Sam McCord. I'm an aquatic biologist. I've been working with this field of study for about 30 years, partly in the private sector and partly for Department of Natural Resources. So, and some of it on Hinkson Creek, and I was subcontracted to help Geosyntec with the project.
Thank you, Sam. Yeah, Sam and I are both intimately familiar with Hinkson Creek and have spent a lot of time in all stretches and reaches of Hinkson Creek. All right. Today's presentation, we'll start out with a health and safety moment. We will talk about the data mining project goals and objectives a little bit more. We'll outline what publicly available data we used, the methods for assessing the invertebrate metrics, the methods for evaluating the invertebrate metrics from a statistical perspective, the results of those statistical analyses and metric calculations. We'll also talk about a winter season data collection effort that we took on as part of the project. And using all those information from publicly available data, metrics, analyses, and results, provide a summary and recommendation as part of the project to the CAM. So for today's health and safety topic, we'll talk about slips, trips, and falls. Regardless of workplace environment, whether it's outdoors or in the office, the Department of Labor attributes slips, trips, and falls to the majority of workplace accidents. For us investigators that work in Hinkson Creek or other streams throughout the country, or regardless of other outdoor environments, to mitigate slip, trips, and falls, let's maintain situational awareness, understand and recognize when things like algae are present that increase you know, potential for slippage. Understand when surfaces get wet, they're often slicker than when they're not. Identify great ingress and egress locations to, for example, in stream environments. It may not be the closest. You may have to walk around to access a stream in a safer manner or safer location. Keeping proper footwear, with the caveat noting that if you're working in streams in Missouri, the Department of Conservation does have a ban on felt-soled waders, but keeping proper footwear with good tread traction, utilizing trekking poles or a hiking stick to assist a walking over uneven surfaces, and then be just a reminder when you're walking on uneven surfaces to keep your hands free and available, and don't keep them in your pocket when you are walking in case you do fall, to help keep your balance. So the invert data mining project goals and objectives are to compile, analyze, and interpret existing macroinvertebrate chemical and physical data to diagnose stressors causing the Hinkson Creek aquatic life impairment. Project began in July, August of 2019 and completed in approximately September, October of 2020. We're now just getting to relay this information to the stakeholders thanks to the COVID-19 pandemic. But the data used for this project, as Tim mentioned, there was a host of data collected from 2001 to 2017 by the Department of Natural Resources. And not only are we interested in Hinkson Creek, we are also evaluating data from the nearby control stream of Bonfim Creek, and also the ecological drainage unit reference streams, which include Monito Creek, Beth Creek, Burris Fork, and the Luder River. You'll note in Hinkson Creek, I have two segments outlined, urban and rural. The rural segment of Hinkson Creek is the upstream portion. And I want to stop there just for a second and confirm with Michelle that you guys can see me transitioning through the slides.
Yep. You're on the projects and goals, project goals and objectives slide, correct?
And you can see the map and table, correct?
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you. I just wanted to make sure I wasn't getting ahead of myself.
Yeah, always good to do.
The urban portion of Hinkson Creek relates to MDNR sites 1 through 6, 1 being at Scott Boulevard, 2 at Twin Lakes, 3 at Forum Boulevard, 3.5 at Recreation Drive or near Providence Road, Hinkson Creek 4 near Rock Quarry Road, Hinkson Creek 5 at Capon Park, and then Hinkson Creek 5.5 at Green Valley Drive, which is also Broadway, and then Hinkson Creek 6 at Walnut Street. So these are the sites within Hinkson Creek designated as the urban portion. The rural portion of Hinkson Creek includes site 6.5, which is upstream of the Highway 6370 connector, Hinkson Creek 7, which is at Hinkson Creek Road, and then Hinkson Creek 8, which is at Rogers Road, and also known to many people upstream of the landfill in the City of Columbia. The 2001-2017 publicly available MDNR data included 172 valid invert community samples, which are comprised of multiple habitats. These habitats that comprise one sample include coarse riffle substrate, depositional areas, and root mat. So there are the three compositions that include one invert community sample. Of those 172 valid samples, 67 were collected within the fall season of September 15th to October 14th. So we have the Hinkson Creek Rural Treatment Group. There were 9 samples. The Hinkson Creek Urban Treatment Group, there were 40 samples. Within the Bonfim Control Treatment Group, there were 12 samples. And the reference streams included 6 samples within the fall period. The spring period included 105 samples. And the spring period includes a time of March 15th to April 14th. So there are more samples in the spring than what there are fall. There are 23 from rural Hinkson Creek, 56 from the urban Hinkson Creek portion, 17 from bond film control, and 9 from the reference. The chemical and physical data used to assess the community and differences were water chemistry parameters. There were quite a few, which we'll talk about a little bit more. Land use, land cover, national pollutant discharge elimination system outfalls within the watershed, and stream flow. Now, through this process of compiling the data and running through the analysis of these data, there are some limitations that we identified, and it's good to let people aware for future data collection activities. Static or one-time data collection are unrelevant to run correlation analyses. Sample sizes that are very small, one or two samples at one or two locations, are again are irrelevant to run correlation analyses. And we do know there have been a lot of data collected from different entities on Hinkson Creek. However, some of the data were unavailable for our assessment. So again, the rural portion of Hinkson Creek, the upstream portion, includes sites 8 through 6.5. The urban portion of Hinkson Creek includes sites 6 downstream to site 1. And taking a 24,000 foot view of the Hinkson Creek watershed and the Ozark Moreau Luter EDU, we see the Bonfim Creek, which is a control, is the nearest stream to Hinkson Creek, and dispersed across the EDU are the reference streams of Monito Creek, Ferris Fork, Beth Creek, and the Luter River. From 2001 to 2017, the Department of Natural Resources collected 187 macroinvertebrate community samples. However, not all of those were considered valid for our assessment. In our diving into the data and reviewing old reports, 15 community samples were removed due to various reasons, including catastrophic drought conditions during the fall of 2012, and then several samples within the rural portion of Hinkson Creek at site 7-8 were either collected during no flow conditions, so not all the habitats were available, or several of the samples were missing root mat habitat. So if not all three habitats were collected in a community sample, we did not consider it a valid sample. So the reference stream, there were 15 community samples collected between 2001 and 2012. The Bonfim control stream, there were 29 samples collected between 2001 and 2017. In the Hinkson Creek rural portion, there were 32 samples collected between spring of 2002 and spring of 2017. In the Hinkson Creek urban portion, there were 97 invert community samples collected between 2001 and 2017. I'd also like to note that during periods of fall of 2015 and fall of 2017, invert samples from rural portions of Hinkson Creek were not collected, again because of lack of flow or no flowing water. And also another condition during the spring of 2012, in urban Hinkson Creek, the lower three sites, 1, 2, and 3, were not sampled due to an automotive parts store fire in the watershed, where automotive chemicals, fire suppressant, and potable water was likely to leach into nearby tributaries and affect that downstream portion of Hinkson Creek. So of the 96 samples collected in the urban portion of Hinkson Creek, 47 of them meet the fully supporting condition for the Department of Natural Resources stream assessment, or Missouri Stream Condition Index, about 49% of the time. you look at Hinkson Creek rule segment, 32 samples have been collected and 25 have met the fully supporting designation by the MISCI score, or 78% of the time. So there's about a 30% change between rural Hinkson Creek and urban Hinkson Creek. The Bonfim control, 20 of 29 samples have met the fully supporting designated use by the Missouri Department of Natural Resources, Missouri Stream Condition Index. And 12 of 15 reference stream samples have met the fully supporting aquatic life use. So not even the reference stream meets the 16 fully supporting 100% of the time. But we do notice that rural Hinkson Creek does meet the MISCI score more often than urban Hinkson Creek. So of the 172 macroinvertebrate community samples, 44 invertebrate metrics were calculated per sample for more than 7,500 metric calculations. These were in the categories of richness and diversity, and the category of composition or relative abundance, in the realm of functional feeding and habitat of the taxa, the tolerance of taxa to organic pollution and sediment, dominance and diversity of taxa, the ratio of certain taxon, and the traits of certain taxa. The metrics that include mayflies, stoneflies, and caddisflies, which is often referred to as EPT, taxa richness, total taxa richness, Missouri Biotic Index, and Shannon Diversity Index are all four metrics included in the MISCI or Missouri Stream Condition Index score. And these are all included in our analyses. After calculating all the invert metrics per 172 valid samples, all the metrics were retained for further evaluation. So, moving on to our analyses of the data. Within the water chemistry, there were more than 9,000 water quality results from 98 parameters. However, the majority of them were laboratory non-detections or included samples of a very small sample size collected at one or two locations during the period of interest. We did, however, come up with water chemistry parameters that were consistently collected alongside invert community samples, including nutrients such as total nitrogen, total phosphorus, ammonia, water temperature, dissolved oxygen, pH, conductivity, TSS or total suspended solids, turbidity, chloride, sulfate, and hardness. Physical data evaluated included the 2001 and 2016 land use land cover from the National Land Cover Database, which includes forest, grasslands, cropland, and developed lands, relevant NPDES layers from the Department of Natural Resources, and flow information from the USGS gauge at Providence, which corresponds to Hinkson Creek Station 3.5. Our statistical analyses of these data included an ANOVA variance analysis of the metrics and the water chemistry based on the treatment groups described earlier and based on season. A Mann-Kendall temporal trend analysis was performed on the metrics, and a Spearman-Rowe correlation analysis was performed on the chemical, physical variables to the invert metrics. An ordination analysis was performed based on season and using water chemistry and to derive unique taxa associated with each treatment group. A last analysis performed were indicator taxa and metrics to determine and identify taxa that were good or indicated an improvement in the community for future use, and also identified metrics that were useful in distinguishing the differences between urban and rural portions of Hinkson Creek. The results of variance testing using ANOVA determined that within season, 39 of 44 metrics demonstrated a seasonal variation, supporting a natural variability. Treatment group differences during the spring season, there were more chironomids, fewer EPT-sensitive inverts in the Hinkson Creek urban portion. There are fewer scrapers and filterers in Hinkson, and more filterers in Hinkson Creek urban. There's a higher biotic index in Hinkson Creek urban. Notable treatment group differences in the fall, there were lower EPT richness in Hinkson Creek urban, and there were fewer pollutant intolerant taxa within Hinkson Creek urban as well. The results of variance testing with water chemistry parameters revealed that chloride was the highest in Hinkson Creek urban in both seasons among all treatment groups. Conductance was the highest in Hinkson Creek urban during the spring. Sulfates were higher throughout Hinkson Creek in both seasons compared to the control and reference. Nutrients, again, like total nitrogen, total phosphorus, and ammonia, were similar among all treatment groups. Temperature, pH, and dissolved oxygen were higher throughout Hinkson Creek than the nearby Bonfim control stream in both seasons. The Mann-Kendall metric temporal trends were used to evaluate changes over time. And these trends can suggest, based on known information about metrics, that a negative trend can indicate a degrading community or a impacted community. A positive trend may indicate a improved or a better quality invert community. And these were evaluated on all treatment groups, including Hinkson Creek urban, rural, control, and reference. In the Hinkson Creek urban segment, there were 15 statistical significant trends in the fall season, 8 indicating a positive or improved invert community, 3 indicating a negative or degraded community. Also within the Hinkson Creek urban, there were 24 notable significant trends in the spring, 14 indicating a positive or improved community, and 5 indicating a negative or degrading community. Within Hinkson Creek rural, there were 19 total trends of statistical significance, 2 in the fall, and both of them indicating a positive or improved invert community. Within the spring in Hinkson Creek rural, there were 17 trends, 6 of them indicating a positive improved community, and 11 indicating a negative or degraded community. It's important to note that in the reference stream, there were no temporal trends of statistical significance in either season. In the nearby Bonfim control stream, there were 28 trends of statistical significance, 15 in the fall, 9 of them indicating a positive or an improved invert community, and 1 indicating a negative or degraded invert community. And there were 13 significant trends in the spring, and 11 of those indicating, or all of those indicating, a negative or degraded community during the spring season in Bonfim control. I did skip over, there were, you know, some of the numbers don't match up to the total trends to positive, negative. There's some invert metrics, we just don't know what an upward or downward pattern in over time means. And so those were considered neutral or variable. And Sam, would you like to add anything about neutral or variable?
Well, some variables are obviously signs of better water quality, like anything relating to the EPT group, the more, the better. And generally, the more chironomids, the worse. So, but there are some variables, macroinvert variables, that whether it's higher or lower doesn't necessarily mean that stream quality is better or worse. And those were ones that we're talking about when we say neutral variables.
Thank you. Results of the Spearman-Rowe correlation analysis with the water chemistry data. Nutrients and suspended sediment variables varied over small gradients among the treatment groups and did not consistently correlate with invert metrics. There was no water chemistry variable consistently correlated with invert metrics among all treatment groups or between seasons. Variables describing dissolved ions, such as conductance, chloride, sulfate, did vary along moderate to large gradients within the treatment groups and were highest at Hinkson Creek Urban in both seasons. The water chemistry variable most frequently correlated significantly with invert metrics was chloride, and in particular at Hinkson Creek Urban in the spring. It was negatively correlated with 12 of 22 good or improvement indicating metrics and positively correlating with 6 of 14 degrading or bad metrics, you would say. The correlation analysis results with the physical data. The flow information from station 3.5 only, median flow was positive related to percent EPT, percent EP, percent ephemeroptera, EPT to chironomidae ratio, percent slow seasonal development, percent rare and drift. Minimum flow from station 3.5 was positive or positively related to the EPT richness, ephemeroptera richness, clinger climber richness, flow exceedance frequency, and flow exceedance frequency at station 3.5 was positive related to biotic index and negatively related to clinger climber richness. The stormwater MPDS outfalls were negatively correlated with EPT richness, trichoptera richness, percent trichoptera, percent clingers, climbers, percent scrapers, scraper to filters ratio, percent rare and drift, and percent non-swimmers. And permitted outfalls were positively correlated with deposited sediment tolerance index at Hinkson Creek Urban. So land use, land cover, within Hinkson Creek Urban, there are greater amounts of urban area and lesser amounts of forested grassland and cropland, positively correlating with percent oligochaetes and percent deposited sediment tolerance index. So, a non-metric multidimensional scaling is a form of ordination analysis used to collapse multiple variables into fewer dimensions so data can be visualized. So each dot on the plot in front of you represents a single invert community sample that is comprised of all habitats. The closer dots represent communities that are more similar, and the further dots are away from each other represent communities of different composition. You'll see using this analysis, we're able to again distinguish that data from the invert communities should be evaluated seasonally, as none of the information overlapped. Overlaying the water chemistry information with the ordination analysis, in the spring season, we can see that the water chemistry parameters associated with the Hinkson Creek Urban portion are most strongly with the Hinkson Creek Urban portion, or chloride and conductivity, which are represented by their ordination on the axis, which is very close together, and the strength of the arrow, or the length, indicates the longer the arrow, the stronger the association. So Hinkson Creek Urban associates strongly with chloride and conductivity, and the rule, control, and reference stream associate more with nutrient parameters and less with chloride and conductivity. In the fall, we noticed that chloride and conductivity again associate, and field temperature associate with the Hinkson Creek Urban treatment group, but not as strongly as what they did in the spring. But still, nevertheless, they are associated with Hinkson Creek Urban. And then the fall, we noticed that again, the nutrient parameters that were evaluated, more associated in the opposite direction as the chloride and conductivity in the direction of the reference control and urban treatment groups.
Well, this table identifies macroinvertebrate taxa that were associated with how the sample groupings fell on the NMS scatter plot. And to really boil it down, there were some taxa that were strongly and consistently, and by that I mean both seasons, associated with single study areas. And these were the isopods, Cicidodia, which are on they're the top thing listed on both spring and fall. They were associated with Bonfim Creek, and the Asiatic clam corbicula was strongly associated with the urban segment of Hinkson Creek in both seasons. And other taxa were consistently associated with multiple study areas. And an example was the caddisfly Trionodes, which is the bottom row of this table. And these were found in samples from Bonfim Creek, from the EDU reference streams, and from the rural segment of Hinkson Creek. And what this is notable about this is they were not hardly ever found in the urban section of Hinkson Creek. So this is a taxon that we felt was good as a distinguishing taxon for the study areas.
Thank you, Sam. When we were underway compiling data for this project, and you know, obviously right away we're able to understand through the ANOVA that there were chloride and conductance differences between the treatment groups and unique to Hinkson Creek urban portions. And that chloride and conductance follow a similar pattern in among treatment groups, with them being the highest in Hinkson Creek urban, although slightly less in the rural, slightly less in Bonfim control, and the least in the reference condition. By plotting the chloride and conductance data from the control, we see that the conductance ranges from 275 to 500 microsiemens per centimeter in the control, which is up to 30 milligram per liter chloride concentration. In the reference, we see a lower range from 175 to 475 microsiemens per centimeter conductance, up to 25 milligrams per liter chloride. In Hinkson Creek rule, we observed a 275 to 575 microsiemen per centimeter range of conductance with a maximum of 42 milligram per liter chloride. And the urban segment of Hinkson Creek, we see a range of 275 microsiemens to 878 microsiemens and a maximum of 144 milligrams per liter chloride. So just keep in mind that 878 microsiemens per centimeter conductivity. Oops, sorry, I went too far. Okay, can you see the chloride conductance figure again?
I see, yes.
Okay, I clicked one ahead, so sorry about that. So plotting those on a linear scale, we understand, or we can identify, that there's a strong correlation between chloride and conductance. So using this information from the historic data, and again, these are collected in spring and fall, we have an understanding that this likely is not representing worst case condition in Hinkson Creek during the winter period. So, Dr. McCord and I deployed continuous conductance monitoring water quality data sondes at five Hinkson Creek stations that correspond to historic invert monitoring locations. Data were collected at 30-minute intervals, and these sondes were left in Hinkson Creek to collect data for 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. We deployed them on December 12, 2019, and data and instrumentation were removed May 12 of 2020. So we deployed on December 12th. Well, coincidentally, December 14th to December 17th was the first winter snow and ice event for the Columbia area in 2019-2020. On December 14th, the area received 0.32 inches of rainfall and ice. On December 16th, 0.36 inches of ice or 3.5 inches of snow. And then on December 17th, 0.14 inches of ice and rain or 2 inches of snow. Hinkson Creek 8, which is at Rogers Road and upstream of the landfill, conductance over this winter period remained relatively unchanged. And I did skip over on the time series plot are the flow data in black, which represent the flow information collected by the USGS gauge at Providence. So the event, the winter snow and ice event occurred on December 14th to the 17th, but on December 28th and 29th, the area received more than 1 inch of rainfall, and Hinkson Creek exceeded 1,000 cubic feet per second. So there was a large volume of water associated with rainfall and stormwater coming down Hinkson Creek. So during this period, Hinkson Creek 8 at Rogers Road remained relatively unchanged from a conductance level. There was a slight increase, but you'll notice that once the rainfall and stormwater entered Hinkson Creek, there was a dramatic decrease in conductance. Our second station was at Hinkson Creek 7, which corresponds to Hinkson Creek Road. We see a slightly higher background conductance, and again, a slight increase associated with the timing of the winter event, and then a dramatic decrease when the 1 inch rainfall event occurred later in the month. The next location, which is Hinkson Creek 5.5 at Green Valley Drive, also at Broadway, or close to Broadway crossing, we notice the background conductance there is higher compared to the two upstream locations. But in response to the winter event from the 14th to the 17th, on the 16th, we start to notice dramatic increases in conductance at Broadway Boulevard within main stem Hinkson Creek. If we look ahead on the time series to the 1 inch rainfall, we see conductance values drop similarly to that of the upstream two locations. The maximum point from our maximum value for conductance from Hinkson Creek 5.5 is over 3,300 microsiemens per centimeter, almost four times that of what we have data available in our analysis. Our fourth location was Hinkson Creek 3.5 at Recreation Drive and Providence Road. Again, we see similar background conductance prior to the event on the 13th. On the event on the 14th through the 17th from snow and ice is the delay in Hinkson Creek, or the reaction in Hinkson Creek is slightly delayed compared to the next upstream station at Broadway. But we see a value of conductance more than 2,000 microsiemens per centimeter. And that carries through a longer duration than what the upstream Broadway location did. We see it carry on about a day longer and then also become diluted once the 1 inch precipitation event hits on December 28th, 29th, in which all conductance values were similar. And our last but not least location we were monitoring was Scotts Boulevard, which corresponds to Station 1. And again, similar to 3.5, we have about a day delay between noticing impacts from the winter event. Background conductance before the winter event is similar among all the urban Hinkson Creek monitoring locations. And again, we see once the rainfall event hits on December 28th, 29th, that conductance values fall back to a level similar to background concentrations. So this gave us an idea that we're underestimating some of our winter chloride and conductance values in our data set. And you can actually see in the data set on December 18th from Hinkson Creek 3.5, and then there's a really high spike up to 3,300 microsiemens. That spike is evident in Hinkson Creek downstream at, or at, excuse me, I said 5.5. I meant 5.5, I said 3.5. So it starts at 5.5 and then is evident at 3.5 and then is evident at Hinkson Creek 1. So over the 152 days, conductance instrumentation were deployed. We collected more than 30,000 data records. These are the maximum values from the monitoring locations, with Hinkson Creek 5.5 being the highest and Hinkson Creek 1 being the next. Average concentrations or average conductance values generally increase from upstream to downstream, but Hinkson Creek 5.5 still remain the highest conductance value from an average perspective. Looking at the 90th percentile of the data collected, there is a complete linear increase from upstream to downstream, suggesting that concentrations over time are persistently higher at Hinkson Creek 1. In all this, we can't forget that Hinkson Creek is an urban watershed. The Missouri Department of Natural Resources manages a Missouri Environmental Emergency Response Tracking System, or MERTS, and then the Missouri Department of Conservation manages a fish kill report database. The heat map shown on your right documents MERTS or NDC fish kill reports in the Hinkson Creek watershed from 2001 to 2017. These incidents include things such as vehicular accident, fire, we talked about the O'Reilly auto parts fire earlier, malfunctioning or failures. So there have been several documented potable water line breaks in the city that have leaked into nearby tributaries, documenting aquatic life toxicity. And there's also been some improper disposal of chlorinated water from swimming pools. So kind of summarizing all this information together, developed landscape in the Hinkson Creek watershed has increased from 4 to 5% from 2001 to 2016. The invert metrics within Hinkson Creek are not consistently decreasing over time. There are evident water chemistry differences between Hinkson Creek, the control and reference streams, and those most notably being conductance, sulfate, and chloride. Invert metrics within urban Hinkson Creek in the spring season correlate well with increased chlorides. Nutrient levels are similar between urban and rural Hinkson Creek and the control and reference streams. And through our experiment collecting data, conductance is a great surrogate for dissolved ions such as sulfate and chloride monitoring. Recommendations from our project, from what we've learned, is that a lot of the impact on urban Hinkson Creek comes from non-point sources. Therefore, we would promote the development of a watershed-based management plan, which will also allow for implementation projects, identification of projects, and prioritization of projects in the watershed, focusing on non-structural BMPs and winter road treatment, doing that by outreach and education, and striving for to find that balance between public safety and aquatic life protection. Over the last year or two, the science team has been involved with folks from the city, the county, the university, and MoDOT, understanding how winter road treatment is applied. And, you know, all these entities follow Federal Department of Transportation guidance when it comes to treating roads and calibrating spreaders. Another structure, non-structural BMP focus would be looking toward treatment alternatives other than chlorides. And then as Laura Weissman gave a great presentation last week, that was more of a structural BMP focus that revolved around attenuating rainwater and stormwater, so as much as possible ground infiltrates instead of just running off. Another prime recommendation out of our project came to BMP performance monitoring. All the entities, like I said, follow FDOT guidance when it comes to applying winter road treatment, but at what point do we understand what BMPs are working, how it's affecting the community and affecting Hinkson Creek? So by retrofitting the Providence USGS gauge with a conductance instrument, which can be easily done, you'd have a long-term understanding of winter road impacts from year to year, because we live in Missouri and no 2 years are alike. If you don't like the weather today, just wait till tomorrow. It'll be different. And then also with BMP performance monitoring, we suggest a rural Hinkson Creek flow and then also conductance gauge station to understand flow differences between rural portions of Hinkson Creek and urban portions of Hinkson Creek. A high winter or a high resolution winter season conductance assessment could be performed to identify tributaries and storm sewer or storm drains that contribute high levels of chloride. We know that the Hinkson Creek 5.5 Broadway site is a good area or is a good an area for increased chlorides, but you could refine that to understand tributaries and identify sources to a higher resolution. In an invertebrate drift study during the winter season would further confirm the chloride stressor, understanding the movement and Lord lack thereof during the season would confirm whether chloride is really imposing a stress to the community. And going through all the previous data collection through whether it be habitat and sediment, there's been some great data collected. However, as I mentioned, a lot of that data was collected one time or it is not collected in a standardized manner that makes it comparable from one data set to another. So we would suggest to the CAM that habitat and sediment assessments be standardized for Hinkson Creek into the future. So consistency, we can use them to their maximum extent. And with that, the full report is available on helpthehinkson.org. And I thank you guys for your time. I think Tim is gonna finish up and then we'll entertain any questions you may have. Hopefully everyone's still there and not asleep.
Thanks, Cody. Let me see if I can open this. Great job. Nice to hear your voice, Dr. Sam.
Thank you.
Well, bear with me for a moment. Oh, it worked. Can you all see that?
Coming through.
There we go.
Yeah, I can see it, Tim.
Okay, wonderful. Just a few more slides to finish up. This is what's wrong with Hinkson Creek, which is the conceptual ecological model from the science strategy document. It shows the interactions of multiple stressors in Hinkson Creek that are possible and the complexities of those and basically the unknowns, the unknown interactions of those structures and those stressors rather. The study hit on multiple pieces of this model. I was going to highlight them, but it certainly, you know, covered temperature, sediment regime, channel flow regime, and others. So those interact, and it's rather complex, and we'll have more to say about that in the science strategy document. So what is wrong with Hinkson Creek? It's affected by multiple issues, certainly geology and climate, historical changes with respect to point and non-point sources, chemical pathways, mostly chemical, mostly physical, and Cody said quite a bit about that, and then the interaction of those pathways and how they affect the community, and then certainly interactions with stream habitats and exposures to stream habitats, and not the least to mention perhaps lack of stream habitat, and how they all affect the invertebrate community, which is rather complex and hard to sort out. So this study was helpful with some of those things, those stressors. We feel the study provided new information towards finding potential causes of impairment. And these additional metrics provided very useful addition towards our understanding of the invertebrate community and the responses to stressors in Hinkson by sorting those out even further. There's an immense amount of work here that Cody did not show. The science team considers this a worthwhile use of funds. We did want to say the process provides additional lines of evidence that while chlorides is an apparent cause of impairment in Hinkson Creek, there are also likely other physical, chemical, or hydrological issues that are also contributing to aquatic impairment. The difficulty here is, for example, sediment is just very hard to sort out and track the effects of sediment on the community, because it changes over time and changes quickly. So with that, our thanks, and I think we left it open to questions.
This is Rob Jacobson. Can you guys hear me?
Yes, we can. Also, if participants want to hit the hide stage button, that'll bring up the kind of viewer as well. But we can hear you, Rob.
Okay, you can hear me. Good. So I just wanted to just put a little bit more of a emphasis on Tim's last point. Page 5.2 in the data mining report says, therefore, multiple stressors are likely causes for the aquatic life threshold impairment of Bourbon Hinkson Creek. Of the potential stressors examined, analysis of hydrology and in-stream habitat sediment were limited due to the absence or lack of available data. And so you could see through Cody's presentation more emphasis on chloride, because we've got chloride data, and we've got another chloride talk coming up that Dan Obrecht is going to give. So the science team thinks that, you know, there's something going on with chloride for sure. But what was emphasized, and Cody did this and Tim did this, is that we don't have the same amount of data to look at in-stream habitat and sediment in the river. And so we don't want to prematurely go all in on one thing until we get a better understanding. Over.
There was a question that came in by text about whether chlorides are a strong enough stressor to induce behavioral drift. And that was, we don't know. Maybe that's something that would be addressed by that recommended drift study that would correspond with continuous probably conductance monitoring. So that was where that came from, was, well, what effect does that have on the inverts? So we think that the answer to that may be yes, but we don't have any conclusive proof.
Yeah, that would address whether or not, you know, we look at things from a toxicity perspective. You know, we have acute and chronic criteria. But before, you know, those thresholds are met, do inverts flee their habitat? And so that would get at assessing whether they do or not, and which could lead to a better understanding of why we get variable results from season to season, year to year.
Cody, this is Rob again. One thing I just thought maybe needed to be clarified was in the fish kills where you saw the effects of potable water. That's a problem, right, because the water's chlorinated. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you.
And I will add to that, there were no documented fish kills from potable water within Hinkson Creek, but there were several within tributaries of Hinkson Creek.
So this is Rob. I'm going to ask another question while everybody's thinking about questions. There's so much data here that every time I hear it, I've heard this three or four times now, I see something else. The relationship with corbicula was interesting, that it's associated with the urban areas. Do you know, can you say for sure that corbicula had the capability of being throughout the drainage basin, or is that possibly a limit on its ability to migrate upstream or colonize those areas? Over.
I think it's a, that's a good question, and I think that's certainly a big influence. I would have to look at the data. It's been a while since I've looked at the data tables. Certainly, you know, that's why just the regional possibilities of that's probably why it's lower at the EDU reference streams and at Bonfim, but the possibilities are there. So it's another thing where we don't know how much influence to attribute to just a natural, you know, a natural regional difference as opposed to a you know, a water quality impact difference.
And as we all know, the lower segments of Hinkson Creek, lower sites, you know, 1 and 2, are impacted by, you know, backwater conditions from the Missouri River when it's at really high stages. So, the, you know, whereas Bonfim Creek, EDU reference streams do not have that condition.
This is Aaron Keyes. Hey, Cody, thanks so much for that presentation. I had a quick question on, you talked about on one of the slides that the, I think it was the caddisfly was very common in the reference streams and in the rural parts of Hinkson, but not in the urban. Can you guys tell me a little bit about the life cycle of that caddisfly and what kind of habitat it likes and that sort of thing? So we could think about why maybe it's not in the urban sections from a habitat perspective and not just from a chemical perspective.
Well, this is Sam. That's a good question too. And one of the potential confusing things here is when we talk about indicator taxa, on that slide, that was really relating to an explanation of some of the results in the ordination analysis. But to get to what I think you're asking, and correct me if I'm wrong, is what kind of taxa, if we went out there and looked in the stream, what would we expect to find in the less impacted areas, the rural areas, the reference streams, Bonfim, and not in the urban, in the urban stream? And we also did identify some of those. And it's not necessarily a matter of habitat differences, because the habitats are available in the rural sections and the urban sections too. But what you know, what the difference is and what we think the differences are causing these, what we propose is indicator tags or indicator metrics, we thought those differences were related to stream quality. So that's that that particular taxon was Trionotes that I think you were referring to. That was an important taxon in explaining some of the results in the ordination analysis, but it was not one of our proposed indicator taxa that are outlined in the report. There are two caddisflies there and a stonefly, and they're all taxa that are commonly found in the rural portions of Hinkson Creek and not so much in the urban portions. They're all considered very intolerant to pollution, and they're all members of other kind of important trait categories that we can go into, you know, in addition to this conversation. So there's a lot of background there, but to boil down the answer to your question, it wasn't necessarily habitat differences between the urban and rural segments of Hinkson Creek in terms of habitat availability. We think it's just the stream quality. That's why these taxa are found someplace commonly, for example, the rural segment, and rarely in the urban segment.
So when you say stream quality, you mean the actual, I guess, do you call that water chemistry, the actual content of the water, you know, what's in the water itself?
It really encompasses everything. Okay. The habitat quality and the stream water chemistry quality, and also the physical conditions that may be natural, like high flow, but they'll differ between those two study areas. So it's really a combination of all of those.
Okay. And then a second question, or I'm not sure what it is, but you guys had a slide about how the positive trends for some of the different metrics. And so just to recap, does that mean positive in a good way? So that we have been improving parts of Hinkson Creek, is that, can I make that statement based on some of those positive trends?
Aaron, the trends that we noted in urban Hinkson Creek, for example, there were both positive and negative in both seasons. But for example, in the spring, there were 14 metrics that indicated an improvement or a benefit to the invert community. And then there were five metrics indicating a decline or a degradation or degrade to the invert community. So there was a mixed bag, but there were more positive than there were negative. So take that with a grain of salt.
Sure. I guess I just want to say that at least some of our efforts seem to be having a positive effect versus, you know, some of the data from 20 years ago, say.
So. Absolutely. I would, if they weren't having a positive effect, then we would see all these invert metrics continue to decline or persist, you know, not see any positive feedback from the community, but we are.
Okay. Thank you.
Hey, Cody, we also just got a question in from Amy saying, which taxa are considered to be the reference taxa?
Okay. Were there?
Well, okay. You mean associated with the EDU reference streams?
Yes.
Okay. Those are... Choroterpes is a mayfly. Nectosyche is a caddisfly. Those were, and Acentrella is another mayfly. I don't know the tolerance values of those, but they're all in the moderate tolerance, right, moderate pollution tolerance range. And that, again, you know, those were things that were, they're on that table because they were found, when they were found, it was basically, it was nearly always in the EDU reference streams. Not necessarily because they're absent or that they're, that impair, you know, that poor quality eliminated them from the others, but just that was how the statistical patterns emerged.
Thank you.
So is this a common thing to do a macroinvertebrate data mining, or is this a rarity for you all?
Well, I would say in the state of Missouri, there are a few streams, that there's no stream that has more macroinvertebrate data collected than Hinkson Creek. So, it's a really unique endeavor. I think it's worthwhile. I think collecting some additional data that we did during the winter season provided us a better understanding of some impacts to water chemistry, but it also, you know, some of that information is available in literature, but kind of, as I mentioned earlier, not all the data were publicly available. I think over time, as publications are released, more data will become available. So all the metrics that were calculated from the invert community samples are provided to the CAM. So I believe the science team will talk a bit more about their priorities and projects and future discussions. And this study, information from this has not reshaped, but either reconfigured a few of their priorities to aid in understanding what is impacting the Hinkson Creek aquatic life.
Okay, thank you. All right. Does anyone else have any questions they would like to ask?
Hey, Michelle, it's Amy again.
Hey.
All right, I'll turn my camera back on. I'm also curious about stoneflies within the Hinkson watershed and what kind of diversity we have there in recent years. We've historically in the past had some pretty good diversity within the pearlidae family, but have we seen much recently? And I don't think I caught that in Cody's talk, if there were, because stoneflies are like kind of the most, well, of course, the most sensitive and the ones that we really want to educate our volunteers within the stream team program on. So I wanted to learn if we actually still have a stonefly population within the Hinkson watershed.
You want me to do that?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yes, it's a limited population, certainly in terms of richness. I think they got Perlesta and Neoperla, and I don't know, you know, there were a few perlids that you had mentioned, but stoneflies, unfortunately, are just not... they're not very abundant or diverse in Hinkson Creek, so they're probably other than perhaps Perlesta, they would be pretty difficult to get some meaningful patterns doing any kind of rapid bioassessment or just bioassessment work that focused on stoneflies.
Cody, do you think that there's still a possibility that some of the tributaries to Hinkson Creek might still have stonefly populations?
It just depends on the year and whether or not, you know, because some of these tributaries to Hinkson Creek are going to lack flow during certain times of the year. So it's just going to depend on year-to-year conditions.
Okay, thank you.
David, I assume that's my friend David Karani has got some questions. How are we proposing to use the indicator metrics going forward? That is really up to the CAM, David. The metrics were determined based on our analysis. We came up with a systematic approach to derive those metrics. And some of the metrics do overlap with the Missouri Stream Condition Index metrics, such as, Sam, do you have that in front of you?
I can get it quickly.
I'll let Sam fill you in on the indicator metrics that were.
Yeah, the indicator metrics, two of them are the same as are used in the Missouri Stream Condition Index, and that's total taxa richness and EPT taxa richness. Three others that were in this study pretty effective at distinguishing impaired versus less impaired stream segments were clinger climber richness, percent intolerant taxa, and the ratio of scrapers to filterers. And none of them were perfect, but all of them they had the qualities that we liked in terms of indicator metrics because they varied over large gradients or fairly large gradients instead of, you know, like the some of the indices, the sediment tolerance index only varies from 1 to 3. So it's pretty difficult to get, you know, much of a, you really have to, anyway, you know what I'm saying. And the diversity index varies over a very small range too. And some of the other just taxonomically related metrics also, they just vary over such small ranges that they're difficult to really interpret a difference between two sites or even two study areas. So we were looking for ones that varied over large gradients and that were consistently showed a clear difference between the disturbed areas, which in this case was the urban segment of Hinkson, and the less disturbed areas, which were the other three. And then lastly, we wanted metrics that were associated with either pollution-related degradation or habitat-related degradation. And that's all, it's identified in the report.
This is Rob Jacobson again, and I'll preface this by saying that in any kind of project like this, there's always a concern about the costs that go into the science relative to the costs that go into fixing the system. And one of the things that I think has come out of this data mining report is an understanding of those metrics that might be more cost effective in terms of tracking the health of Hinkson Creek. I don't think that means that the Missouri Stream Condition Index sampling can be abandoned, eventually, because I think that's necessary. And Tim can tell me if I'm wrong about this. I think that's necessary to get Hinkson Creek off the impaired list. But in terms of narrowing down what we think is really going on and trying to figure out what the most cost-effective mitigation is, some of these metrics from this data mining report might be very helpful to do that in a cost-effective way. Over.
Well, that's true, and they can also be, those metrics can be calculated regardless of the sampling methodology. So if there were, you know, you don't have to abandon the historical methodology to supplement it with, with new types of collections.
So, Sam, for example, because there's such a difference between the spring and the fall, potentially just drop all the fall sampling. What would you think about that?
Well, I can certainly see the argument of dropping one of the seasons. The problem with the spring sampling is that it's so variable, and a lot of that is tied to natural reasons, which is just the life histories of the really common and abundant taxa then, and also the physical conditions, the flow conditions, which are generally more variable in the spring than in the fall. So I kind of like the fall samples because they accentuate, in a lot of cases, the except for probably the chloride issue, they accentuate the other potential stream impairment factors because they have a chance to act over the summer, over low, you know, during low stable flow conditions.
I have a comment to add to that, Sam. Just to add to what you were saying there. We've always considered the fall sampling a good indicator of how well or how good the potential is of a stream to recover if it has been stressed from any of the wintertime stresses that you would be seeing the effects of in the spring sampling. So, and we saw this over there in the Kansas City streams pretty commonly, is that you could kind of tell which ones had a better potential to be able to recover from those winter stresses by looking at the fall sampling data. And so that is one thing it does kind of help out with, is that it does give you an indication of that potential of recovery.
Well, that's a good point, and I agree.
Hey, Barry, could you identify yourself? Some people don't know your voice.
Yeah, this is Barry Poulton from USGS, and I'm on the science team.
It's good to hear you, Barry. All right, David has another question. What about focusing more sampling effort on fewer sites? Is there anything in the data to support that? You have any add to that?
Well, I think there's always going to be a balance of what to trim and that's one of those things that I would leave to the science team or whoever that they put that responsibility on to make that decision. I mean, it's, you know, you're always walking a tightrope between the cost and the possible information.
I would like to add to that, Sam, that in the Hinkson Creek rule segment, we have 8, 7, and 6.5. Frequently, sites 8 and 7 are non-flowing for part of the year, but 6.5 has still been a good comparable location to 7 and 8. So there's an advantageous, you know, to eliminating a couple in the rural segment.
This is Rob Jacobson again. So what about sites 1 and 2 that we know are affected by different processes through backwater from Missouri River? Over.
Those should really be assessed in other candidate reference or control streams, because we don't have that information, that database from DNR to understand how those backwater conditions impact community assembly.
Right, and if I interpreted what you meant, Rob, it was is it valid to include those and compare them against other sites that don't have the river influence and that don't have comparable habitat? And that's a good question. That's for the science team and the regulators to make the call on. But I certainly see what you're getting at.
I will add that.
And I would just
go ahead. No, so go ahead, Rob.
Okay, well, I was just going to add that the science team discussed with the DNR quite a bit about defining a new segment downstream, and the regulatory difficulty in doing that was extreme. But that's, for the stream condition index. If we're talking about the partners wanting to do a better job of pinning down what the source of impairment is, maybe those sites could be dropped. Over.
Rob, I was just going to add that the EDU reference streams are located in a position that they are not impacted by any backwater from Missouri River. And I do agree with DNR. It does take a long time to develop and assess criteria for unique habitats and unique situations, because ultimately DNR not only answers to they have to answer to EPA, and EPA has to approve that methodology alongside DNR.
I have one more quick question. This is Aaron. And I saw it in the scatter plot, but I don't know if you really talked about it. And this is maybe an anecdotal thing that I've noticed in the data in the past, is that it seems like our MISCI scores are better when you've sampled when we've recently related to a flow event, to a rainfall event. Would you say that this data kind of bears that out, or not necessarily?
Aaron, there were some indications based on the correlation with the physical data at station 3.5, where we had flow information, that median flow positively related to percent EPT, percent EP, percent ephemeroptera, EPT to chironomid ratio, percent slow seasonal development, percent rare and drift. So the higher the median flow, the higher the values for those important taxa groups. But on the contrary, minimum flow was positive related to EPT richness, ephemeroptera richness, cleaner climber richness. So there's some back and forth with flow from the flow data we had.
So, Aaron, this is Paul Blanchard. Some of the poking around of the data that I've done, I would say there's definitely not a clear indication that really high flow events are the dominant cause of issues. But we have all sorts of different size pulses that could be bringing in all sorts of things, whether it's sediment or chemicals of various sorts. So there's not a clear indication of a flow effect that I would say.
Are we on?
Yep. Okay, thank you.
And Aaron, this is Sam again. Flow is one of those variables that we alluded to that is really kind of a neutral, or it's, you know, there is a range kind of in the middle, so to speak, that is good, and on either end of that range it's bad. So it's not doesn't lend itself well to correlation analyses and analyses like the, you know, that are included in the ordination analysis, and that's probably partly why we get some contradictory results.
Yeah, I guess part of my question is, you know, we only sampled once in the spring and once in the fall, and it was kind of, you know, whenever it got scheduled, and sometimes it was before a rain, sometimes it was after a rain, and, you know, I guess that's part of the statistical analysis piece that maybe I don't understand, but, you know, I'm just trying to put some, just trying to understand it, I guess.
Aaron, we did look at flow information from 3.5 that included basically pulses or like events, like high water events, because that's the only station we have true meaningful flow information from, unless some other more data become available. And there weren't any correlations between the flow pulses and the community metrics.
But literature very frequently has indicated that those do have an effect on biological communities. So even though, and it, I mean, this is something that you, you know, you really have to wrestle with in any field studies, even though we know or strongly suspect that something is having an effect, our data may not show that. And I think that happened pretty frequently with the Hinkson Creek data.
Right. Yeah, I could see where a really large event could, you know, wash macroinvertebrates down or wash more pollutants down. And I think I get the point where, you know, there's kind of a median flow that's beneficial, and then too much or too little is not necessarily.
Exactly.
Great. Yep.
Oh, and then I know we're close on time, but I didn't know if any of the stakeholders wanted to comment on just quick thoughts on all of this, like ideas of where we need to head.
Well, this is Todd from the University of Missouri. As far as I'm concerned, where we need to head is where the science team tells me we need to head, because this is, once again, really not my field.
This is Amy Meyer from the Missouri Stream Team Program, and we are not alone in handling this kind of issue. So this is something that is happening everywhere. And if we can maybe get the opinions of folks from other states and other types of topographies, maybe we can work together.
This is Riley. Oh, go ahead, Cody. I'm sorry.
Oh, I was just going to make the general comment. I've been in, you know, Hinkson Creek numerous times. I've been in other urban streams throughout Missouri, throughout the country. And urban Hinkson Creek is a fantastic urban stream. The riparian corridors are well-preserved. Point sources, you know, from a continuous discharge perspective, have all been eliminated. The city's done great work eliminating small systems and condensing to a regional sewer. So Hinkson Creek is a fantastic urban stream. It's just not quite up to par with the reference condition. But the city, the county, university have nothing to do, or should be patting themselves on the back with everything that they've undertaken over the last year or the last years to improve Hinkson Creek.
Oh, it's an awesome stream to float in the right water level. So I highly recommend it. It's awesome.
Yeah, so considerations of what could be done, and the city, county, and university have already done quite a bit with respect to improving the stream. So we will have more to say about chlorides in the next study. I mean, obviously, you know, that is something that seems to stand out here. We don't think, and speaking for the science team, please others speak up, because we have a lack of data. Or some of those data are very hard to collect. We don't think it's the only issue, but you do have some things to work with and potentially consider in the future. Over.
Hey, Tim, it's Amy here. So, of course, I'm recommending a recreational use of the stream. So, What do you feel about that, even though, like, this is kind of like the science type of organization that we're doing here with the macroinvertebrates and the science data? Do you have any recommendations?
I'm not quite sure what you're getting at, Amy.
Well, mostly, like, well, how do you feel about recreating on Hinkson Creek?
In what respect? You mean floating, fishing?
Yes, all of it.
How do I feel?
Yeah.
I mean, I would float it if that's what you're asking me, but certainly not in extreme high flows, because you have to ride the pulse down in this stream.
Right. So I guess what I'm getting at is, wanting to improve the stream so that we get more recreational activity on the stream.
I see.
Yeah. There's a lot happening on the stream, and I think we're on the right track.
So, Amy, this is Rob Jacobson. In the science strategy report, there is a section talking about stakeholder views of Hinkson Creek and how they value it. The studies were done a while ago, and we've said that it might be time to redo that study to come up with that information. The CAM process does not deal with bacteria, but it is another concern on Hinkson Creek. I fish it and weight it, and I floated it, and I'm just careful not to get anything in my eyes. Over.
Yeah, I was going to bring up the same thing with respect to, you know, any urban stream for that matter.
So I guess maybe my angle would be to recreate in your local urban stream and be as careful as possible.
Sure. Absolutely. Yeah,
this is Barry Poulton from the science team. I do want to comment on that. I think, one of the studies that we had really hoped might be of some interest, and I think we still have it down as one of the studies that was rated among our recommendations as the science team is to look at the fish community, and in particular look at the sport fish populations that Hinkson Creek has in hopes that it would eventually increase awareness and you know, amongst the public and so forth. It kind of highlights the fact that, you know, there are other recreational uses that Hinkson Creek could be used for besides the typical ones that people can really see real well, like the bike trails and so forth. And so, you know, that was one of the things I had really hoped for, was that, you know, if we had some fish community data, you know, we might not be able to necessarily use it for evaluating, you know, the stream quality quite as much. Even though that is being used in other places, but also the awareness of other recreational opportunities that maybe aren't so obvious to the, you know, to the average user.
Yeah, this is Carl Scala. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, this, Columbia City Council. I of course, I'll defer to the science team being on the on CAM, but it seems to me that I was impressed by your slide for recommendations, which suggested that about three things. I don't have it right in front of me, but additional monitoring sites to compare the rural versus the urban sections, the winter road treatment issues, and the improved long-term measurement consistency from year to year. I thought those were great recommendations and something that the CAM team can take to heart and then defer to the science team for advice. So I appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right. So unless there's any really pressing questions at the end, might go ahead and end our time. And I want to thank Cody and Sam and Tim for presenting. And again, I will be sending out posting this recording on the helpinghinkson.org website if you guys want to refer back to it. And we have two more presentations coming up the following 2 weeks about chlorides and the science strategy. So if you guys are wanting to dig into a little bit more about what the science team is thinking, what next steps might be. Until then, go out and enjoy the Hinkson. And if you guys have any questions, please feel free to email me. Thank you all for attending.
Thank you, Michelle.
Thanks, Michelle.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.